welcome to another Happy Pod, the only podcast in the world. My name is Nathan. As always, I'm joined by my co-host, Lawrence Thomas. Hi, C. Hello.
Hello. No rude name?
Oh, I don't know. I was thinking, I was hoping something would come to me. It didn't. Hello.
Hello. Our brains are a bit fried anyway. We've just spent the better part of 40 minutes doing technical fixing.
You did.
Yeah, but you were the guy in the chair. You were directing me through it. So what I'm saying is we have a right to be tired and not fully with
it. Great. Well, that's exactly what you want to say right when you're about to start a podcast.
They know what this is. They know what we're about by now. Hello, how are you?
Slapping your mic?
It's new. Yes. I'm still getting to grips with the fact that I can't touch my desk much anymore.
You can if you get a shock mount. Listen to this. See, that was me touching my desk.
I can still hear it a tiny bit, but I'll get the shock mount anyway.
But it's not ba-doom. What kind of an idiot buys a microphone for himself and doesn't buy a shock mount?
I'm a fool. What can I say?
Is this how this podcast usually starts?
I was thinking maybe there was a segment that we do, but there's not really, is there? I know what's thrown us off. You normally tell me to shut up and then ask me what we do.
Ah, oh, yes. See, something did not feel right.
It didn't. That's why my game is off.
No, there was this really weird energy, and something did not feel right. Lawrence, no one cares about everything that just happened. Tell us what this show is all about. Full disclosure: we haven't recorded in like 2 weeks almost. So clearly, it's thrown us. Lawrence, tell us what's happening.
For the first time in history, I am happy to hear you say those words. Nathan, this is the show where we get together and we talk about all things pop culture related. We talk about movies, we talk about TV shows, we talk about games. That is coming up, not as soon as we anticipated, but definitely soon. Nathan's shooting me dirty side. So bombastic side eyes, I believe, is the new term the kids are calling it.
Did you do your thing?
No, I'm still haven't done it. We try and have a good time, we keep it positive. That is what we do here. Does it feel better now?
A little bit, I guess. Yeah, a little bit. So this is the show. Welcome, everyone. Now that we're all caught up.
I like how that's mainly for me and you at this point. Like, everyone that is listening probably knows what we talk about and that intro.
Well, every podcast is someone's first podcast.
That's true.
That's the golden rule. You have to record every podcast as if it's going to be the first time that someone is introduced to your show.
As like, if you were to find a new podcast, do you start at number one or do you just start where they currently are at?
It depends on the podcast because like if it's got like a specific theme or something, I'd probably like, for example, Do Go On, another podcast I listen to. When I was first starting that's a podcast where they do like reports on stuff that happened in history and big events and notable stuff and that sort of thing. So the way I got into that was just choosing something that seemed interesting to me. And I picked a few out and then just went and listened to the whole catalogue because I really liked it. Things like this podcast, another Happy Pod, you can easily just scroll through and like pick out a movie or a TV show you're interested in and just listen to that one, which I'm sure some people do. My dad has started listening to the podcast.
Hey!
Hello, my dad. Hello, Carl. Hello, my dad. And he's doing exactly that. He's just going through finding things he like, because he was going to go start from solo right at the beginning. And I said, don't do that. That's a bad idea.
You watched all your dad's pride of you in his eyes just fade away. And you were like, no, I can't let that happen. No, sir.
He messaged me the other day. He said he listened to the District 9 episode.
The one where Connor had to make microwave chicken halfway through.
And I cannot remember a single thing that was said on that episode, but he seemed to enjoy it. So.
Well, that's all right.
So there we go.
That's what we do it for.
Shout out to my dad.
Yeah, we do it for Carl. Well, I imagine a fair few people will pick up this one, hopefully anyway. Because Guardians 3, Marvel. We don't do a lot of Marvel anymore.
No, it's your favourite franchise. You love Marvel. You're always first in line to see every movie when it comes out and stuff. You're very excited for it. So you was chomping at the bit to see the latest installment of Guardians of the Galaxy.
I mean, I was for this one, yeah. I hate this joke because, like, I don't quite know, like, the parameters of it. Like, because you're right, I do see a lot of them in the cinema. Sometimes it's work, sometimes it's just something to see.
Not, and that's not a bad thing at all.
No.
Oh, you go see movies. Oh, got him.
No, but like, just on the podcast in general, I think there's too much. If we were to speak about everything Marvel, this podcast would almost be half Marvel.
Yeah, we'd never stop. We'd be like the Marvel podcast, which I don't want to be. And, you know, and I don't want to say Marvel has fallen off, but it's not as shiny as it once was.
No. And that's part and parcel with, like, it's old now. Like, it's not, like, yeah, it's not as shiny, but it's also kind of like the stuff that everyone fell in love with is mostly gone, and it's now new stuff that no one's all that interested in. I don't want to say no one, it's still making... I mean, is it making a lot of money anymore?
How did this do? This was the last movie, wasn't it?
It didn't, like, fucking blow the roof off anything. It didn't make a billion, but it did... This, I think this came in just before, like, the summer of all the flops.
By the way, when did fucking $1 billion become, like, the benchmark of... this movie is acceptable because it made a billion... Fuck off! That's, like... Do you know how many movies have made a billion? It's so few. Like, yeah. In terms of the grand scheme of movies there are and movies that have crossed $1 billion, it's such an exclusive club.
It is.
Stop that.
It is, but it's like we were saying the other day at the end of the Barbie podcast, they spend so much fucking money on them now that if they don't make a billion, they just don't see it as viable.
First of all, yeah, but I do not care about a corporation's profits.
No, nor do I.
Yeah. So, like, that's their problem. Fuck them. I don't care. I don't fucking care if you make your money back or not. All right? That's your fault for spending fucking $400 million on it, you fucking idiot. Yeah. But I don't know.
I feel like this one did well.
Worldwide, $845 million.
Well, there we go.
Which is very good. Very good.
That's extremely respectable, yeah.
Yes.
Especially in the same summer where, like, an Indiana Jones movie made, like, $100 million or something ridiculously bad.
First Guardians of the Galaxy made $773 million. And Guardians 2 made 869, which is just above. So it's around about the same benchmark, sort of. So, yeah.
So he's 3 for 3 on a very tightly nice average.
Yes.
My God, yeah. They're going to feel his absence, I think. But yeah, all right, tell you what, let's rip the Band-Aid off. What do you think? When did you first see this as well?
Some time ago.
when it came out, right?
Not straight away. Like, I waited a bit. It was a few weeks into its run, I think. It was whenever Spider-Verse came out, Across the Spider-Verse, it was that weekend. Because I went to see Spider-Verse and this on the same day. I did the double feature.
The roller coaster of emotion. I love that when you go out to the cinema, you're like, I'm here, I may as well see a bunch.
I got to pack it in. Like, I mean, I'm not coming back. Like, let's get this done while we're here.
Yeah. You know?
I'm doing one trip,
yeah.
So I'll make the most of it.
No, I think, I don't know, what do you think?
Of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3?
Yeah.
Look, no.
don't do your look thing that you do.
I like doing my look thing. No, it's good. It's good. It's great. It's good fun. It's clearly made with a lot of passion and love for both the characters and just filmmaking in general. You kind of get the sense that it is like sort of a swan song for both the cast and crew, really. And yeah, I feel like it's a fitting end to the trilogy with some spin-offs in between of the Guardians, really. Yeah, yeah, I enjoy it. I think it's good. I think it's a good movie. Hot take from me.
Even hotter take from me. I too think it is a good movie.
Boo, you're a hack.
I know. No, I don't know. I feel like in this watch, I kind of realised something that it's like... Because obviously this was so fucking heavily delayed because they fired James Gunn, rehired James Gunn, but James Gunn was busy. So he had to wait to start production on this, then COVID, then it finally released. So by this point, these characters are very much like pre-Endgame characters. They started the phase in the run-up to like the Infinity Saga. And now that everyone's firmly out of that, and we've been out of it for like an entire phase now, and there's so many fucking new characters.
Oh yeah, is this the first? Wait, no. This is the second movie of Phase 5.
Is it? Yeah, it's either that or, like, the tail end of Phase 4. I don't fucking...
No, I think Black Panther was the last movie in Phase 4. Oh,
okay,
four.
Right.
So Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantum Shite, and this, I think, are the first two. Has there been anything else?
I think it's those two that have been in the movie. The movies, yeah. It's been a while since I gave a shit about a group of characters in Marvel. Like, but yeah, but right, basically, I just think that this is like, the whole movie in itself is like motivated by like something like desperate, and like the whole plot kicks off because they're trying to save one of their friends who is like, has a very real possibility of dying, not only because it's the last movie, so a lot of people were expecting this movie to kill off Rocket.
Yes, mainly because the marketing for this movie was like, we're going to fucking kill this raccoon. Like, I saw a meme that was like, you know, like the John Wick poster where he's just surrounded by like people holding guns at him. It was just Guardians 3 marketing being like, it was just Rocket in the middle of, like, just everyone pointing, because that is the market. It was like straight away, like, we're going to kill this raccoon. So I was like, well, obviously you're not then. So, but whatever. That's not the movie's fault. I was thinking there while he was talking. It's not world ending stakes, which is strange to say about a movie where a world literally ends.
Yeah, it's very true.
Yeah, because it's not. It's kind of more low key. You know, it's not Thanos. It's not big fucking end of the universe stuff. It's more personal to the Guardians, really, which I quite enjoy. I think it's more of a fitting story than some big cosmic. Million spaceship, you know, all that shit and stuff. So,
it's a group of people on their own fetch quest that kind of get caught up in, like, we should probably fuck this guy up while we're here. Like, it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I feel like, do you remember something that I thought about watching this is, like, do you remember in Endgame, like, the whole hype for Endgame was, like, there's been such a fucking catastrophic loss and death.
Yeah.
How the fuck do we come back from that? And then, like, all the heroes are like, some are defeated, some are desperate, some are hopeful. And when you
some
go in...
Some are Skrulls.
Huh?
Some of them are Skrulls.
Some of them are Skrulls now. Yep.
I don't buy it, but whatever.
But, like, everyone went into that movie so excited because, like, it was fueled by something that mattered. Like, at the end of this movie, we were either going to get a bunch of our characters back or they were going to stay dead. They were never going to stay dead, but that's the movie stakes.
No. Yeah, yeah.
And in this, I feel like it's the same thing. Like, everyone doing stuff. Like, the amount of times, like, they just go into an obvious trap or, like, something that they probably shouldn't do. And they're like, we don't have time to give a fuck. Like, we got shit to do. We're on a stop clock. Like, otherwise we lose our mate. I don't know. Kind of, just, it felt like it mattered in a way, if that makes, which is so silly, but it did. And it's about a raccoon.
Well, yeah, but it's a cool raccoon.
It is. It's
true. Got a Brooklyn accent. Why has he got a Brooklyn accent?
No, no. And even as a child, too, like when he's a little baby and he's...
I'm a little raccoon. I'm from Brooklyn.
I'm definitely not a pitch-shifted Bradley Cooper whatsoever.
I don't think it is. I think in the credits it was someone else.
Do you reckon they like merged the voice? Because Bradley Cooper's 100% doing it as well.
I don't know. I think it might have been maybe Sean Gunn. I don't know.
I know Sean Gunn's a mocap, but does he voice act as well?
I don't know. Yeah. Couldn't tell you.
Who knows? But yeah, that's another thing to say as well. Like, straight away, I think this is like, it's crazy that the opening shot of this is a tracking shot of a raccoon walking around basically the base, which is a dead god's head. And it still feels more tangible and like you can touch elements of it than in like the quantum realm of Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania. Yeah. Like, it's, I don't know, I feel like there's a lot more. This kind of goes back to what the conversation we were having ages ago. I can't even remember if it was on the podcast, but like, this is what happens when you bring someone that gives a shit versus someone that's there to like maybe give a shit, but also roll over if Kevin says so.
Yeah.
A conflicted man.
See, it's difficult because like, I agree, but like, I don't know. We've had this discussion before. I don't think it was on the podcast. We were just talking one time.
Yeah.
And I don't necessarily think that Peyton Reed was just like, yeah, sure, whatever. Like, yeah, I don't think I think it's just unfortunate the way the movie turned out, but I don't think that, like, he was just like, oh, I don't really care about this movie sort of thing, and I'll make it look shit if we need to just get a quick one out. Maybe that's naive of me. Maybe. I don't know. I just like to think filmmakers want to make films rather than just, you know, just roll over and do what fucking studio execs tell them to do. And again, it is difficult to argue because there is a clear difference in the results of, if you do compare this to Ant-Man and the Quantumania, because yeah, that movie looks like fucking shit. It looks like, and I hate to say that because I really hate to, you know, discredit the work of VFX artists and that sort of thing, especially at this time with everything going on.
Yeah.
And it's not their fault at all. It's because, you know, they're fucking underpaid and overworked and given fucking no time to do the job that they need to do, really. But yeah, it just does not look great. I feel like probably more attention was paid to this movie, more resources were allowed to Guardians because Guardians was probably always going to make more money than Ant-Man 3.
Yeah.
So I think it's kind of that sort of thing.
I see where you're coming from, because like my cynical take would be like the one-liner take that would sum up my cynical approach to it is like some directors want to make movies and some directors want to make $1 million, basically.
But I don't think that's the case, though.
No,
I don't think any... Well, maybe, but if you want to make $1 million, why would you be a director? Because, like, it's not an easy job.
No.
There's so... Especially if you're, like, already a name in the industry, there's, like, easy fucking ways for you to make $1 million. Like... I just think that, like, if you want to make a movie, then you clearly have to have a love and passion for it. And again, maybe I'm just being very bright-eyed and naive here, but I don't know. I just like to think. And because Peyton Reed has made good movies, though, as well.
Yeah.
Like, the first Ant-Man is great. I don't think it's a case of, you know, from the first Ant-Man to that movie, he's then gone, no, I don't care anymore. I just think it is a case of, like, Marvel and Disney probably not giving him, number one, the freedom, and number two, the resources to do what he needed to do properly.
Yeah, I think there's absolutely a fair point to be made in the resources allocation. Like, there's no way that, like, Groot and Rocket and like, a bunch of other stuff in this is able to look as good as it does whilst they're like, they can't even soft blur a background fucking correctly in Ant-Man 3.
Groot looks so good, people thought he was practical.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And he's not, he's entirely CGI, but like, people thought he was an actual fucking person in a suit.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
There's like a testament to the performances as well there, because like, all the Guardians just talk to each other and you believe like, oh, that man's talking to a raccoon. He's not. He's talking to Sean Gunn on his hands and knees.
With a little fucking head on his head.
Yeah.
With a little raccoon head on him. But,
I don't know. I just think that, like, we'll move on from like the filmmaking aspect, I guess. But like
it's a good conversation now, because the raccoon, it fucking looks great.
Yeah.
Like, the movie opens, like, we see Rocket as a baby raccoon looking all scared and stuff. And then it kind of like, the camera like slowly pans in, zooms in on his face, and it transitions into older Rocket. And it's so good. Mm. It's so detailed. It looks so good. It's like fucking, you know, back to the Andy Serkis Planet of the Apes movies, just the fucking level of detail and work put into those apes and the performance capture and everything like that. It's crazy good.
Yeah.
And if I can segue into my favorite semi reoccurring segment, Nathan bullies Christopher Nolan.
Yeah.
I just think that there's this is what happens, and this is how you can show a respect and a love for VFX working artists and the work they do, rather than just fucking disparaging them all the time and being like, no, my movie doesn't have CGI because CGI is bad and I don't want it, rather than just accepting that it's a tool on how movies are made and it can be a very useful and very good tool, you fuckhead.
Yeah.
But hey, yeah, whatever.
No, there is definitely an element of like, I mean, you're right. It's a tool to an arsenal. And if you could, it takes a fucking talented director to be able to shoot for VFX, like,
yeah,
to know when VFX is going to be there and to allow the artists enough clear space to do their work.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, no, it does take a skill. What baffles me, and I just clocked it while you were talking about the, like the detail in his hair and like the Matt Reeves, Apes movies. But like, there used to be a time where CG would struggle to even create hair. And now you can tell that Rocket is older because of the fine, like, grayness in his hair and the wiriness of it.
Yeah, it's crazy.
It's in fucking... And, like, you again, you're 100% right about the fucking allocating resources, because, like, yeah, it looks incredible. It does, and there's not a moment you don't believe it.
Yeah, it does. All the way throughout it, it looks great. There might be some wonky moments at some stages of the movie here and there, but I think overall it's quite good.
Yeah, really. The bit where they jump out of the High Evolutionary's office, a bit shaky.
Yeah, a bit shaky. Yeah, a bit. So some of the shots of the although it was visually impressive, some of the shots of like the station that's like made of like flesh and stuff looks a bit weird.
Do you think? I love that.
Yeah, some of it. Yeah, it looks. Just, I don't know.
I think it's hard because that is a practical space that was built but also enhanced heavily with CG in the background.
I mean like the shots of the outside of it.
Oh, sure. Specifically.
Yeah.
Or like cutting into the flesh door and stuff.
Yeah.
No, I can see that.
But for the most part, again, great, and like I say, a whole lot more visually pleasing than Ant-Man and the Wasp. By the way, Ant-Man and the Wasp isn't in it. It's called Ant-Man and the Wasp, and the Wasp is hardly in the movie.
Yeah, it didn't someone work out like her screen time compared to Scott Lang's, which is like, it's night and day.
It's crazy. Anyway, we're not talking about that.
Well, no, the thing I was going to say, and we'll, this, I think, good point, unless you've got anything to talk about filmmaking-wise.
I mean, maybe, but...
We can circle back around to shit.
Yeah.
What I think is really interesting is, obviously, I spoke about how there was a fat delay between Volume 2 and this. And, like, when did Volume 2 come out? 2017, I want to say?
2017, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a fucking while.
We were in second year at uni?
Oh, Jesus, that makes me old.
Was we?
Yeah, we definitely were, yeah. But yeah, no, so that there was a massive delay, and since then there has kind of been like this, a lot of people were kind of interested how they were going to handle Gamora in this. Like,
yes.
There was a, because basically, right, for, and there are people out there, I know it's not a lot of people, but there are people out there that like the Guardians movies and don't tune in for every fucking else, every other thing that Marvel do, including Endgame.
Yeah.
So, like, there's an element of, like, they have to deal with the fact that the version of Gamora from Volume 2, everyone knows this is listening to this anyway, but, like, she died, but she's not dead. It's now a different version of her from the past that doesn't have any of the memories of Guardians 1 or 2.
Yes, because she was taken from her timeline pretty much just before Guardians 1 happened.
Yeah, like, so, like, probably like a week before Guardians 1 happened.
Yeah.
Which so is, like, yeah, I don't know. I do think James Gunn was kind of, I feel like a lesser director wouldn't have been able to handle it in the way that he did. Because he was dealt a shit hand. Like, he was stiffed for a bit.
Yeah.
And there are, like, he's spoken quite candidly about, like, he knew it was happening. He wasn't overly keen on the choice, but he's powerless to stop it. Endgame was the big one. There was not a single thing that James Gunn could have said to disparage that decision happening. And so he's kind of just had to go, oh, all right, I've been setting up this character for two movies, and in the third and final one, she's a completely different person. And I think how he handles that is, like, really, really fucking interesting in this, because he still gives her a purpose and a character, but he also uses that to build off the journey that Peter's been going on as well, which I think is quite cool. What do you make of all the Gamora stuff?
To be honest, I think it's everything with Gamora in this movie. I think it's kind of strengthened by what happened in Infinity War and the choice to kill that version of Gamora anyway. Again, it's difficult to say for sure, you know, a scenario where there is a Guardians 3 with regular that version of Gamora just carrying on.
Yeah.
You know, a version where she didn't die. It's difficult to say because that doesn't exist. So it's hard to know what the plan was, how that would look, what her and Peter's relationship would be at that point and that sort of stuff. I don't know. But in terms of the story we got, I like that it's not just something that's just immediately, she died, but now it's okay because we got another one.
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah, that would have been awful.
Yeah, like, it's her death meant something. Mm. And Gamora died. Like, she fully, that Gamora is dead. She is gone, dead, not coming back. This Gamora is not her. She looks like her. She talks like her. She screams like her, which is great. I always love me some Zoe Saldana screaming.
Just box office magic. Like,
literally. Like,
yeah, I mean, so yeah.
Whenever she screams in a movie, like, $2 billion. Let's go. It's great. but she's absolutely a great actress. She always does a great performance. But yeah, like I say, I think what James was able to do with the story and how that's, you know, her and Peter's relationship is non-existent basically at this point, and he's trying to like force it on her, like,
yeah,
he's like no, trust me, you love me, like, if I can just make you understand, you love me and we can be the greatest couple again and we have so much fun, trust me, I'm not being weird, I'm not being like, trust me, like, we are the greatest couple ever. And she's like, dude, fuck off.
Yeah.
I don't know you, like I'm not the woman you lost, all right, I'm my own person, let me be me. It's a great story, it's really interesting, and I like that. It is kind of sad, like, where it ends up, but I like that it's a lesson that Peter learns, that, like, he has to let Gamora be Gamora because his Gamora is dead.
Yeah.
It's sad. It's heartbreaking even, but she's dead and she's not coming back, and he needs to move on from that, basically.
I think it also, like, it speaks to the uniqueness of their relationship prior. Like, the same woman before the growth of that happened with Gamora in Guardians 1 and Guardians 2...
Yeah.
Like, it speaks to the uniqueness of their relationship. Like, you can't replicate it. Even with the same two people, one different set of circumstances, you can't just put on the same shoe and pretend it fits. Like, it doesn't work like that. And I think that this is, like, there's something so fucking cool about how, like, the center of these movies has always been, like, trauma and kind of balancing that and finding, like, a way to kind of, like, bridge the gap between fully healing, but finding a way to just kind of get on with a bit of pain. Obviously, but this being the final entry and the final time James Gunn is going to handle these characters, like, they needed to wrap up some of those wounds. But yeah, no, there's something really interesting about how Gamora has this brilliant line, which is like, what is so broken inside of you that you need me to be something?
Yeah, great line.
Yeah, it's incredible. And also, like, literally since...
And screams perfectly, my Zoe.
Yeah, just, I mean, anything she screams is perfect.
Yeah. I just wanted to yell at me. Yeah. Like, that'd be great.
The way she like storms off afterwards, I'm like, I'll follow you. Just keep screaming.
This movie is like 75% just people yelling at each other.
Yeah.
And it's great.
I wouldn't have it any other way. Like,
yeah.
But she says that line to him, and it's like, there's something about like how since like the death of his mum, he just basically... And Mantis says this a bit directly later on, like, he just jumps from woman to woman to help fill the like the Meredith Quill hole in his heart, basically.
Mummy issues, like, to a fucking T.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And like, and Gamora like rightfully calls him out on it, and it's like, I don't know, it just allows like, it's fitting that his ending with her is like not romantic and is unsatisfying romantically, but traumatically very healing for what he needs to hear and what he needs to accept to move forward.
Yeah,
like, which is basically just let go. She's gone.
It's where they end up is so much better for both of the characters and the story, rather than an alternate version where they do end up together again by the end of this movie. I think that would cheapen it, really.
Yeah.
I think that would massively cheapen both the sacrifice and everything that came before, and even this movie itself, really. So yeah, as weird as it sounds, I'm happy they're not together.
Yeah, but also, like, you saw the ending of Guardians 2. Like, I understand James Gunn would have done something and made it work. But, like, you're right, this is more interesting. It's more, yeah. There's more conflict to it. Like, they were pretty, like, those scenes in Volume 2 where Gamora's like, if this guy isn't your dad and if he turns out to be a dick, we'll just kill him. Like, they're happy together.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
there's one thing that the Guardians can't be until the last 10 minutes of this movie is happy, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So I don't know. But yeah, no, I just think there's, like, I love how, as a director, he was kind of stiffed, didn't know what he was going to do, and then turned it around and made it better somehow.
It was extra stiffed by Thor just hanging about, being like, oh, I'm one of you now too. Yes, I'm a guardian of the galaxy.
And then Love and Thunder, they were like, kick this fucking guy off the ship.
Yeah, and then Taika just immediately went, oh, let's change that. Let's let's immediately just flip that around.
Was it the box office for Thor Love and Thunder cut its legs off so Guardians 3 could run?
Yeah. Like, Tiger really took a bullet for James, but yeah.
That is so correct.
Yeah.
But yeah. Let's talk about Rocket, because he's like, there's even another line later on in this, which is like, it's a bit meta, like it's been his story all along. And it's so true. Like, Rocket has been the secret protagonist of all of these movies. And yeah, I don't know. I just thought his story, I was traumatized while watching this for the first time in the cinema. Like, sad story, but early listeners of the podcast will remember I had a little furry dude, my cat. Oh, no. I know, it's going to get sad.
Keyword being had.
Yeah, basically. And it was sad, and he's no longer with us. And there is imagery in this movie that took me back to a very sad time.
Did your wife watch this with you tonight?
Not tonight. She actually left because of I was watching it tonight.
That's what I would have been surprised if she had.
Yeah.
Because I remember she was there very upset when you watched it first time.
Yeah, it was genuinely the first time since I was like a child that I was tempted to leave the cinema while the movie was like barely even getting started. Not because of the quality of the movie. The movie's incredible, but like it was a lot. But also I don't think like I'm alone in that. Like, this is very viscerally affecting stuff.
Yeah.
Just like, I don't know, the lengths that, also like, this is kind of what I was saying about the beginning, that it feels like it matters more, like the brutality of this in general. Like, people are coughing up blood, people are getting half beaten to death.
Yeah.
It's fucking like, it's, some of it is really hard to look at, especially for characters that you really, really love. And Rocket being like the smallest, cutest, and furriest, it just makes it even worse, basically.
It is pretty gruesome. It really doesn't like pull its punches, and it does like push that, whatever fucking PG-13 probably pushed that rating like as hard as it can.
Yeah.
Really. Which is good, because you know, it's very interesting and intriguing, and yeah, difficult to watch it sometimes. I know a lot of people who are, you know, particularly, you know, animal lovers, and oh, that's always so weird to say, because like everyone's an animal lover, but like, you know what I mean, just people who have like an affinity for animals,
yeah,
and stuff.
Yeah.
It's a difficult watch for a lot of people, and hey, that's understandable, because yeah, there's a lot of fucking animal cruelty shit in this movie, and it's purposefully difficult to watch. It made all the more sweeter when that fucking revenge moment comes about, really. Rocket is like kind of the heart of the movie. That's like not surprised to anyone, but like,
yeah,
he's kind of out of action for the most of it. Like, straight away he's fucking taken out, and then most of his story is like flashbacks and stuff that came before and all this sort of stuff. And it's not really until like the final act of the movie that he's back in play, really. So it's like, yeah, the movie is built around him, but he's also kind of not really in it much at the same time. It's a strange combination between the two, but it works very well though.
Yeah, and I think like as that being like the framing device, like when you remember, like think about all of your favorite Rocket scenes from Volume 1 and Volume 2, riding on the back of Groot, shooting a gun, like he's in Endgame being swung around by Bucky, shooting a gun. He's jumping through a load of trees in Volume 2, shooting guns. Like,
he likes guns.
But there is something really interesting about like like you say, taking him out of play and kind of like we he's so used to like putting on his whole thing is like putting on a bravado of I don't give a shit and like and kind of deflecting any pain with just anger and snarky comments. And like for us to finally be able to like see that side of the story, find out what happened, and also like not really get to see him pick up a gun again until he's ready to accept it and change it is really, really interesting. I don't know, just like all of those scenes where like, because also like James Gunn is like is torturing you for this movie because you know that these characters aren't making it out. Like, you know all of Rocket's mates are gonna die.
Yeah,
and like of course you do because they're not in Guardian. Like
they're not around anymore.
Yes.
Then, like, if he loved them this much, why are they not around?
Yeah, like, I'm supposed to believe they all escaped. They flew off together in the sky forever. And then Rocket went, I'm done now. And I'll see you guys.
And now I live with this tree or whatever.
Yeah. So I don't know. There's just something so great about that. And I think, like, the moment where he, like, kind of has to, not choose, but, like, he's so close to accepting death. And like this is like towards the end of the movie, but like with the walk into the light with Lila moment,
he kind of does accept it.
Yeah,
he goes for it, but it's Lila who stops him. And sure, it's not real, part of his mind or whatever, but who gives a shit? Like, it's she's the one who stops him from, like, she said fucking, like, she says to him, well, she says like, oh, we're all playing over here or whatever, and he's like, can I come? She's like, yeah, of course, but not yet. You know, you've got shit to do first. You gotta save your family and get that prick and all this sort of stuff. So
yeah
and it's a great moment.
Yeah, he is like very willing to accept that like he's gonna die because of like that stupid fucking, like, someone considers him to be like worthwhile technology, so like anyone tampering with him, they'd rather him die than be pulled apart and be of use to anyone else other than the High Evolutionary. So like Rocket is about to accept death, still kind of believing that his purpose was to suffer and to create a better future for someone else. And what I think is so fucking good about this is Rocket's purpose is absolutely to create a better future for someone else, but not in that monstrous and horrific way. It's to be like a protector and a guardian, and that's why he ends up leading them. And I don't know. Also with that scene in general, like the scene where Rocket basically does die, that there is, I don't know, like, that's the realest one of these movies have felt in a very long time. I don't know, and you kind of, you see, like, Peter screaming and, like, pounding on his chest to, like, try and get him back after he thinks he's lost him, like, refusing to give up. It, like, ties into the decision he makes to go and see his grandpa at the end of the movie, because, like, he finally gets why that being in that room and being that guy is hard.
Yeah, I think all the stuff with Rocket is very... very well done, and it is just a great choice to make him like the emotional heart and pull of the movie. All like the flashbacks, they're so fucking cute and they're so fucking great. And like his and Lila and Teefs and Floor, I think, is the rabbit. Yeah. And just an absolute great, immediately you just fall in love with all of these characters and you're like, oh my god, you're all so fucking adorable, please, for the love of god, do not die. They're gonna die.
Yeah, it's just a countdown to them dying. Yeah.
Yeah, and they do, and it's fucking devastating. Like when they get free, you're like, oh fucking, it's coming, and then like you hear the gunshot and everything just stops dead. Oh, it's such a fucking knife to the heart.
Yeah.
It's, and Rocket's reaction, just the guttural scream from a fucking raccoon. And I'm here crying my eyes out because an otter just died. And then the way he just fucking leaps at fucking the High Evolutionary and just tears his face clean off.
Yeah.
It's such a just well-crafted moment. Which gives us, like, you know, obviously a lot of context of the rest of the movie and stuff, and it's really great. I think what I enjoy the most about Rocket's story in this movie is kind of how it's bookended, really. I mean, it's a little on the nose, but we start off with fucking Radiohead Creep, and Rocket, he's surrounded by people, but he's alone, and he's just going around fucking listening to Radiohead, listening to the most self-deprecating song of all time, calling himself a freak and a loser and all this sort of stuff, and then juxtapose that with the end of the movie where it's fucking Florence and the Machine's dog days are over. He's dancing with his family, with his friends, surrounded by everyone.
Yeah.
It's a great bookend. It's a great fucking contrast.
Oh, it's incredible. And like one of the few movies that gets a pass for using Creep. So
yeah,
we'll allow this one, James Gunn.
You're on thin ice.
Yeah. But no, you're right. Like, yeah, just to see the difference between him completely isolated and alone.
Imagine using Radiohead in a movie that you made.
I don't know what you're talking about, Nathan. Yeah, and another movie where there's an animal that pulls at the heartstrings as well.
Yeah, good voice acting.
I think so. That's for no one.
No, that's for us and us alone.
We won't elaborate. No, yeah, you're right. It is a really, really lovely bookend. I think, like, do you know what I love? Like, it all feels real. And like you were saying, that moment where it all comes crashing down and you hear the gunshot, and the camera just slowly pans down to reveal Lila's been shot. Mm. It's not like a laser. It's not like a fucking, It's not like a pew beam kind of Tony Stark repulsor, whatever. Like it's,
yeah.
And there are those. It's almost, the movie is almost exclusively people using weapons like that.
Yeah.
But this time it's just a fucking gun. And like,
yeah
it's a bit sci-fi. It's not the local Glock or whatever. But like, it's a gun as human as you'll find in this world.
Yeah.
And I don't know, there's just something about it just, yeah. And
but there's the 1-2 punch. It's, yeah, fucking Lila's been shot, Rocket's now got to kill these cunts. He's got to shoot the High Evolutionary Guards while they're shooting at him. He's killed them. Oh, great. Now, fucking
yeah.
Teefs and Floor have been killed now as well. And it's just, ugh.
There's no, like, glamour to it as well. Like, it just turns around and it's just an animal riddled with bullets. Like, it reminds you of those fucking despicable Tory pricks that fucking post pictures of like the animals that they've killed.
Oh, yeah.
And they're like posing all around it happy, and the animal is just, it's like it's such a, quite literally sometimes, the elephant in the room. It's just a lifeless corpse that people are throwing up signs next to.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, it's disgraceful. And like, yeah, just that we can get onto this in a sec as well. Like, in that sequence, like, firstly, it's, they get you with that. We speak about a lot about this in Still Got Legs, our Doctor Who rewatch podcast. Doctor Who often play this trick where they introduce a noise and then put so much chaos around the noise that when it creepily stops, you don't notice it.
Yeah.
And they do that, but this time with a mechanical rabbit screaming.
Yeah.
And it's like, she's that
Lila Teef's Rocket Go Now or whatever she screams.
Yeah. And she's the one with, like, the movie sets up that her, like, she's kind of the most limited in terms of like her.
Very childlike.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, she's literally just saying, like, Rocket Teef's Floor, go now. Rocket Teef, like, same shit over and over, which is clearly just a fucking panicked rush of thoughts. Mm. And then when it stops, you don't notice it. But like when you see and you just kind of. And do you know what? The thing that fucking gutted me more was that, like, when Floor starts those screams, she's in the cage, and when the camera shows her dead, she's tried to run, and she's out of the cage by like a good meter, and it's like, oh no. Like, it's the one of them scenes, the more you think about it, the more you're just like, I hate life.
Yeah, it's absolutely brutal. All the fucking voice actors did a phenomenal job. Obviously Bradley Cooper as Rocket. It's Linda Cardellini as Lila, her second mother role.
Yes.
Because she's Hawkeye's wife and a woman and a character in her own right as well. I don't know who did Teefs and.
I think Teefs is a comedian. I'm not sure who.
Is it? Let's have a look.
I think so.
I'm not familiar. Oh, yes, he is a comedian. Yeah. He's the guy from People Just Do Nothing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you know the, what's his name? I can't remember what he called. Chubbly G, is it? From...
Oh, shit.
Yeah, yeah. He is quite actually a really good comedian, actually.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah,
he's
yeah.
in Barbie as well.
Who's he in Barbie?
He says here he's a warehouse employee in Barbie.
Couldn't pick that up. But yeah, no, just great. And that scene made all the worse for... Like, it's the kick you while you're down moment. It's the, like, how do you make a villain even more disgusting? It's have them have them mock someone in pain for someone that they something that they've just done.
Yeah.
And the High Evolutionary, what a fucking what a final boss for this team.
What a just fucking absolute prick ever. Just the most fucking insecure, fucking inferiority complex mixed with a god complex. Fucking just an absolute cunt. I was cheering when he died because, my God, just the best villain they could have had, but also just a prick.
Apparently he's still alive, according to James Gunn.
Okay. If Gamora's knife to his stomach and everything else did not kill him, surely the big exploding ship that exploded did.
Yeah, so I'm with you, and I watched this twice in the cinema, and I think both of those times that what you're saying makes more sense. In James Gunn's own words, however, he is imprisoned on nowhere. He is alive and being kept... He's not, though, right? This is something that Marvel want to keep every fucking door open.
Why?
I know, you never need to see him again.
You don't. This is... I'm actually more for, like, a fucking villains staying around for longer than one movie. I think that's actually an issue Marvel have had in the past, where they like, kill off their villains after... Like, Ultron. Like, a big issue was totally fucking getting rid of him, and now we seemingly can never use him again. That's an issue Marvel we've had. This is the exception. This is like where you go, kill this fucker, never let him breathe again.
Yeah.
All right. Like, yeah. He does not need to come back. It was a great performance. It was a great role. It was all of it really served the movie well. But he does not need to come back.
No. And his story is so thematically linked to Rocket that bringing him back will retroactively undo the growth that you've done to Rocket in the movie.
Very, very well done. It just pops into my head as well that, like, they really make a point of the AP-913, AP-193, whatever it is, like, just repeating that over and over again. He's always, never once calls him Rocket. It's always AP-193. And it's said quite a lot throughout the movie. So that when they get to that point where he screams AP-193 and then Rocket goes, "My name is Rocket." Yeah. It's such a fucking fuck yeah moment.
And he reloads his gun and he's like, "Rocket, raccoon."
Yeah, it's great.
Yes, you are, my friend. Also, like, it comes part and parcel with James Gunn's affinity to big extendy guns, which he loves.
he does love a big extendy gun.
He loves a gun that takes three cinematic beats to reload.
Just the most impractical thing ever, but... It looks great on a film, so...
Yeah, I saw James mention this, I think, months ago on the Weekly Planet podcast, and it's something that I thought was really interesting.
Oh, James, your boss, James, not James Gunn.
No, not James. Oh, yeah, sorry, yeah, context.
Yeah.
Mr. Sunday Movies, as I call him. he said, like, it's just an interesting point that, like, Rocket has gone his entire life believing that, like, he'll probably never see this guy again. But, like, my God, he's got the shit in place. He's like, if I ever cross this guy again, I know his tricks and I've got something on my leg that I can press that, like, is impervious to his, whatever his power is. Just interesting that he was like, I don't know. Also, there's an element of, like, yeah, it's cool when it gives us a cool moment. But at the same time, like, he's been living in fear his entire life. Like, you see it when he comes back and he's, like, on the mend.
When he hears his voice, immediately it's just fucking trauma and PTSD.
Yeah.
It's immediate fucking shit.
The camera does the obligatory off-the-tripod steady cam shake to show you that the panic attack is happening.
Yeah.
Never cheered harder than when the Guardians, like, basically just fucking pass him around like a hot potato to smack.
Yeah. Everyone got a fucking licking. Everyone got, like, one shot at him, which was great. They all teamed up to, like, support their boy, which was
just brilliant. And that's great, something. Really. There's something in that as well about how, like, his downfall comes at the hands of a group of kind of pained weirdos working together as friends.
A bunch of freaks and fucking complete the most dysfunctional family you've ever fucking seen. Like the scene where they go to Counter Earth and the that like. humanimal, they are, I believe, yes, they're called. A humanimal, they go to that humanimal's home and like they're trying to help them out or whatever, and it's, Drax is lying down on the couch because he doesn't it's long, I can lay down, and they're all just yelling at each other and everything. It's so dysfunctional, it's such a mess, but it's great. That's what's appealing about
it. That's something as well, like I wrote down fairly early, like in the first movie they work together because they're the only people that can work together and the only people that know about it, and they're thrown in circumstance. And they decide at the end to be a team. In Guardians 2, you get to see that family a bit tighter, but there's still friction. And then in this one, like, time has passed, obviously, for them as well. But there is an element of, they're never done growing. They're always dysfunctional because they just clash. They're just different personalities. And even as they love each other as much as they do, like, the whole movie is bred out of, let's save our friend. And every single, like you said, they're all getting their licks in, they all show up to support their boy. Like, it matters to every single one of them. It's the most important thing that they have to do is save one another when shit goes wrong. But it doesn't stop them just the entire time bickering and fighting. And there's that beautiful scene of, like, Mantis, Nebula, and Drax. And it's basically just, like, Nebula is so practical and so concerned with being, like, useful in, like, a plot propelling way. How can we progress? Yeah. And Mantis is like, that if that's all you see as worth, then like, what is the point? Like, Drax is fun and he makes us laugh and he's sad, but he tries his best. And like, that's something equally to celebrate in people.
And then he's also shown his worth as well by comforting the children who are fucking terrified out of their mind while all this is going on as well. So
I love that. That's something like, James Gunn always goes for, like, the, I don't know, there's something, I read this somewhere, that James Gunn always figures out what the most, what the easiest idea is, and then what the most interesting idea is. Drax, he chooses the idea that is, like, it would be funny alone if Drax started making monkey noises, but it's funnier because, like, what he's doing is a monkey noise, but it doesn't sound anything like a monkey, so there's there's two jokes there that are both as funny as each other.
Yeah. That moment is so good. My daughters used to love when I made monkey noises, and then he's just clearly doing a robot impression, which is very funny.
It's brilliant.
And then he's got a line earlier in the movie when they're going to, like, Rocket's just been taken out, and they're like, they're going off on that mission, and Drax is saying, like, we'll go, we'll kill them all. And then Quill's like, no, we're not going to kill everyone. We'll kill some people. No, we're not killing anyone. We'll kill one man, one stupid, dumb man.
And it, yeah, Peter's right. It just gets to the point where it's just, like, sad. Like, why do you have to kill someone?
It's great. Dave Bautista is so good. He's such a... He fucking nails the comedy of Drax. Just the absolute deadpan, completely serious, but saying the just the dumbest shit ever. He's so good at it. He's
when he's like even my butt makes analogies.
he's so good. I love him so much, and I can understand why he's like he's done with Drax now, and I can respect that. I feel like we're probably done with all of these characters, if I'm being honest.
Well, apparently not Star-Lord.
Chris Pratt has said something very different.
There'll be no point to segue around to this. Like, what's he said?
Well, he was asked on a red carpet at some point, like before the strike, obviously, that like if he now that Guardians 3 is wrapped up, if he sees himself coming back and playing Star-Lord again, and he was like, he just basically said something along the lines of, for me, like, it would have to be something really, really interesting because we kind of, like, wrapped everything up, and that's what he considers to be the end of that character. But, yeah, just a big Star-Lord will return at the end, but, like, really? No. But
Does
he need to?
The legendary Star-Lord will return when you rewatch these movies at home.
Yeah. I don't think he needs to, though, really. I think all of them... The story's all wrapped up kind of well. Obviously, I'm always open to more stuff, depending on what it is. But yeah, Dave Bautista again, great. Zoe Saldana, great. She loves to yell. Vin Diesel is not in these movies. He's not.
Well, he came back for an hour this time to do one more thing.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, James Gunn wouldn't have done this, but or let's be honest, it very easily could have been fucking AI now, couldn't it?
Yeah, it could. It's not. He is there, but like, you know.
But he's not. He's not. No. Like, he's doing his Fast and Furious bag. Like, that's what he's up
to. No, we're right. I love Groot. The character of Groot is great. I do like the moment at the end where he says, like, what is it? He says, like, I love you guys. Yeah, I think he says.
Yeah, yeah.
We're trying to think, like, he's not just suddenly talking. I think, like, that's what they hear, like, when... Because all throughout the movie, he's, like, saying, we are Groot. And then, like, yeah, good point, mate. Yeah, bang on. Yeah. Like, they understand him. And that's, like...
It's the... We speak about it sometimes. It's the Chewie thing, isn't
yeah,
it? It's
yeah,
the,
of course.
We're not let in, but they understand what's going on, and we get it through context clues.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, James Gunn, that's how I read it when I was watching it. And then James Gunn, I think he said on Twitter when someone asked him about it, like, that's very much it? Us right. being part of the family.
Yeah.
And being in on understanding him.
You know who is great... Karen Gillan, man.
I mean, everyone in this is no perfect, I think, but she is a cut above. She's fantastic.
Karen Gillan is fucking phenomenal. And I think in general, her career is very interesting because she could very easily have gone down the route of being like typecast as like the pretty girl and all this sort of stuff and, you know, all that sort of stuff. Because she is a very beautiful actress and she's great. But she has an affinity for playing just the biggest fucking weirdos ever. Yeah, yeah. Like, look at all her. They're all fucking freaks, man. And Nebula is so... I don't know how to describe it. There's something just very not quite right about Nebula. Like her, well, she's been tortured and everything, so that kind of makes sense. But she's got an odd way about her, which is just very intriguing. And Karen Gillan just plays it so well.
James Gunn has like said something, and I think Karen Gillan said this as well in some sort of behind the scenes thing. Mm. And the voice for Nebula,
yeah.
Apparently James Gunn's direction on helping Karen Gillan land on a voice. Because for everyone that doesn't know or isn't familiar with her outside of this, like, she's Scottish and very Scottish.
Very Scottish, yeah.
Yeah, she sounds absolutely nothing like Nebula.
If you join us on the I Still Got Legs, you'll get to know her soon enough.
Okay? Yeah, it's true, yeah. But so her voice, the direction James Gunn gave her, is halfway her on an extremely pissed off day, halfway Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, right, okay.
Because that you get that from, like, the whole... She has that smokiness to her voice, which is very, like, does. I'm doing this, very husky and kind of thing.
Yeah.
Brilliant. And you're right, she does. It's so easy to play it like a pissed off thing, but she just plays it like a deranged, I mean, half computer weirdo.
I like the progression of her character throughout these movies as well. Not just this one, throughout all of them, really, because, like, she's gone from a villain in the first movie.
Yeah, literally, yeah.
Yeah. Literally one of the main antagonists of the first movie to the fucking fully fledged member of the team. And not only just a member of the team, a member of the team who really fucking cares and loves her found family in these Guardians. It's great.
In a really understated way as well. Like, she's constantly been like, you're an idiot, fuck you, like, all of this.
Yeah.
But then, like, there's moments. And I think there's some kind of... something in the script that kind of... I don't think it goes into that much detail. I think it's just kind of a surface level. Oh, that's interesting. Where, like, I guess her having Gamora on the team for as little time as she is, as early on in the movie as she is, like, in a way that's, I guess, Nebula grappling with, like, God, was I like this? Fuck me. Like...
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
Give a shit about something other than yourself kind of thing.
I really like the idea... and this isn't necessarily touched upon in the movie, but I like the idea that she is, like, a fully fledged member of the team. She really loves these people, but she especially loves and is really determined to help get Rocket back to just back to normal and back to health and stuff, because Rocket was the only one that didn't get dusted out of all the other Guardians. So it was just those two. Like, they were the only two left. And there's a beautiful moment in Endgame itself where, like, when she gets back to Earth with Tony Stark, that, like, they just have, like, a reunion moment and just the realization that they're the only ones. And they just, like, kind of sit on the steps of the spaceship just holding hands.
Oh, I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, Yeah.
My God, yeah. You forget about this kind of shit with this much distance from a lot of Marvel stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's really interesting. Also, like, I guess they're both... I mean, like, so, in a way, you can kind of see the Guardians trilogy as being, like, basically the trilogy of bad dads. Like, you have Thanos being a major player in the first one. You have, obviously, Ego, and then you have the High Evolutionary. But, like for characters that would connect with each other, both cybernetically enhanced weirdos that were tortured and pulled apart from a young age by their father figures or their creators or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's definitely a nice link there.
She's got a very cool arm this time around as well.
Her arm is so cool. It's like it does everything.
Well. Yeah.
I like that moment where like there's part of it that's like very obviously like James Gunn as a screenwriter thinking about stuff, and then there's other stuff where he's like brush that under the rug quickly. Like when when they rock up and those weird kind of like pig demon things are like, you can't come in because your whole arm is a gun and there's a no gun policy. And she's like, okay, fair enough. He's like, scan the human one. Scans him like, yeah, he's got no guns. It's like, don't scan the big one because there's too many guns in him. And we need...
He's all made of wood.
I mean,
He's a big naked tree. You're not going to think he's got guns in him, are you?
That's true. That's another thing I like. That now Groot is back to a normal size.
Yeah.
I love the moments where like... Because you see his head get cut off. And like he just has like little, you get to see Groot in a few forms in this movie. Like he's got his little spider legs.
He's like adult size now, but apparently he just never stops growing.
Yeah.
Like, in one of the post credit scenes, he's fucking huge, man.
Do you reckon like every now and again they just like cut one of his legs off and they're like, let's trim you down a little. Like this is impractical. We have one spaceship and it's not this big.
Yeah, probably. I don't like the spaceship. I don't like the Bowie.
Oh, really?
No, I don't. No, I just don't like the design of it, really.
You don't like that, the double floor cockpit thing?
Not necessarily the interior, more just the exterior of it. I feel like the Milano is like more of a classic looking ship, really. I don't know, there's something about the shape of it, which I'm not necessarily a fan of. It doesn't look visually exciting to me.
It feels blocky.
It does, yeah.
Yeah.
It's not like cool spaceship. It's weird spaceship.
Yeah, it's true. It doesn't have that. Yeah. The Milano had that sleekness that you felt like could cut through space.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I'm with you there. Adam Warlock. He's the weakest part of the movie.
Will Poulter does a good enough job. He's got some funny moments and stuff, but it's a bit too haha Marvel comedy at some points.
Yeah.
It's a bit too I don't know. It's just it's a bit silly, isn't it? And it's supposed to be, but
the High Evolutionary, not the High Evolutionary, the Sovereign have always been like they're the go-to for the punching bag gags in this franchise. They're like the silly, self-serious gold morons, and he is everything all the punching bag and like gag moments that they've been, he's like all of them rolled into one.
I think he's supposed to be like, because he's quite new, isn't he? Mm. He's like, because he's not even born by the time of the second movie, so he's like, he's a child basically in the body of fucking 30-year-old Will Poulter, ripped Will Poulter, or whatever.
With his new quiff, which does sport him nicely.
With his new quiff, yeah. There is that weird moment where, like, Peter Quill's dying at the end because he's in space, and then they just weirdly just recreate the creation of Adam. That was so random and out of place. It's like, oh, and here's Michelangelo's the creation of Adam.
It was very weird, and also, like, I was waiting for it this time round. And then, like, there was that... It's such a quick shot that it cuts away. It almost feels unsure of being there.
Yeah, it does.
Like, for the life of me, I cannot work out what they were trying to get across with that.
I don't know if it's supposed to symbolize something that I'm just missing, or if it's just one of those things that, like, James Gunn went, this will be funny. Let's just do that.
But it was like, it's such a series. it's the potential death of the protagonist of all the three movies.
Yeah, but
it's not typically a moment you'd be like, how can we insert some absurdist humor here?
I don't know, but yeah, it's there. It's there.
It is. I like the way he flies. Mm. I like the way the camera seat watches him fly. Yeah. I don't know, because I think I was maybe watching it now more so that we're hearing a bit more about like James Gunn doing Superman, and like there's a it's an interesting effect. Like the camera like whips around him, but he stays still, and like the world kind of distorts when he flies. It's not just like a motion blur, which is like an easy effect that a lot of people do.
Yeah.
The Eternals, as I think Eternals, this is maybe an actual hot take, and I think we spoke about it anyway, but like we both like the Eternals, right? It's
The Eternals is, I think, or take out the Spider-Man movies, and the Eternals is my favorite movie of Phase 4.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What other movies are in Phase 4? I can't even remember.
Shang-Chi, Black Panther, both Far From Home and No Way Home. Eternals, Black Widow, what else?
Thor,
Love and Thunder.
Yeah, I would I prefer, I personal enjoyment, I like Shang-Chi more.
Shang-Chi's good.
Yeah, and I think Wakanda Forever is probably a better made movie, but I like Eternals. Yeah, but one thing the Eternals is guilty of is like the flying effect is ropey as fuck. Like, it just doesn't look visually interesting whenever Icarus flies.
I think it does.
I think the super speed is very good for Makari, I think her name is.
Yeah. I guess with the Eternals, there's nothing necessarily different. It's just pretty standard stuff, really. It's just a man floats up and flies. Yeah,
basically.
Yeah.
I think this one, I mean, it wasn't like such a distinct visual choice. It wasn't like the Time in a Bottle X-Men difference of like how it's normally portrayed, but like it's very, I just thought it was visually interesting, nice and bright. And I like the goofy. The first time you see Adam Warlock, and he's like, there's that song that goes ding 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 ding, 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 and he's just ding, flying with his face just pointed directly at the lens, moving slowly forward.
It's a strange shot, but
it's great.
Weirdly interesting.
But that's I don't know. It is more fun, and I think like a lot of the camera work in this, like, and this is kind of, I guess, budgetary stuff as well, but also like maybe just a better DPs. I don't know who shot a lot of the Marvel movies, but like the way stuff reveals itself in this, like the appointment with Gamora, how Peter, like, it's on Peter and then it spins round to reveal Gamora coming through the crowd.
Here's something. Why is one of the Ravagers a wizard?
Well, but you find that they're not in Doctor Strange 1, it was quite exclusive, but then like in the end of the second one, they're like, it's just a school, like, come here.
Yeah, but like, did this weird fish guy go to that school?
I guess so. But like, look, if you're saying that, then you have to pull up a big criticism on somehow Ned is a sorcerer in No Way Home.
No, but like he's just figuring out in that movie though.
Yeah,
like, he just picked up the sling ring and is like kind of just figuring out as he goes along. But like, this guy's a full wizard.
Yeah, but Ravengers are all ex somethings that are now weirdo thieves.
Yeah, but he's a big fish guy.
He can be a fish.
Did he go to Kamataj?
Yeah, definitely. There's loads of weird fucking things at Doctor Strange's school of wizardry and stuff.
It's true. There was that big bull guy. Multiverse of Madness. We forgot Multiverse of Madness.
Oh, we did. I liked that movie.
I like that one a lot as well. Yeah. So maybe not my favorite, because that's probably my favorite.
Yeah. Definitely more interesting than Eternals.
Yeah, but it's good. It's good.
I just saw a tweet that had like a picture of Cillian Murphy's Oppenheimer and Brian Tyree Henry from Eternals, and it just said these two canonically have beef. Because like...
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, that's funny.
Very, very funny.
That is funny.
We've been going a while. Do you want to do some quick things and then wrap up the ending?
Yeah, I was going to suggest some quick things to try and get through the rest. First of all, Mantis. I always love Mantis. Mm. I always love new and interesting ways to see her powers done and how she can like get her like fighting people and being like, oh, you're a kitty cat or whatever. It's which is very funny.
And it's like, you're madly in love with him. And Drax is just like, oh God.
Drax just so uncomfortable, just being like, thank you.
But it's like, it's so accurate as well. Like that is that is how people talk if they're being hit on and they're just not a fan. Yeah. They're just like, yeah, thank you. Yeah. Oh yeah, cool. Thank you. Yeah, cool. Yeah, it's very good. I put down the action geography and choreography in the No Sleep Till Brooklyn sequence.
Oh, so good. So fucking good.
Yeah.
What is it about hallway fights that's so satisfying, man?
But like,
what is it?
Just like, also remember that like half of that shit, like, is practical and half of it is CG. Like, yeah. Rehearsing that must have been a fucking murderous, torturous process.
Yeah, it's definitely cheated. It's not a full one-shot, because there's definitely cuts in it.
Yeah.
But it's great, though. It's still great.
Yeah. I also think, like, one takes, yeah, they're good, but, like, also a lot of the time they're impossible. Like, the movie 1917 was built off of being like, we're the one take movie, and there's like 100 shot like cuts just hidden behind walls and stuff, so you don't see it.
I would say 1917. There's a, we'll get to it and Still Got Legs, but there's a fun one shot in series 7 which I can always very clearly notice the cuts in, but it's still quite interesting. But it's great because it like goes from the Doctor being on the ground in London to running into the TARDIS, to flying somewhere, to getting out of the TARDIS in a new location. And all of that in one shot? That's impressive for Doctor
Who.
Yeah,
that is quite impressive, yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. Those are good little things. Cosmo. I like Cosmo a lot. I fucking love that, like, Cosmo's whole arc and thing is just like, you called me a bad dog and I fucking hate this because I'm a good dog. God, that's so funny.
I like that it's like, Kraglin has always been the side character of these things as well, but like in this movie especially, like, it cuts back to them. They're on like a world, not like a world, they're on a very important mission to save Rocket's life, and it cuts back to them and they're all just playing cards and they're still arguing about Kraglin calling her a bad dog.
And everyone's like, Kraglin, just tell her she's a good dog. And he's like, nope. And they're like, ah!
You fucking hell.
But I like that to Cosmo, that is the absolute worst thing imaginable. It's that whole thing of dogs just love being called good dogs, but hate being called bad dogs.
Yeah.
It's very funny. It's great.
My dog has a little crush on Cosmo, the space dog.
Now, does she? Is Rosie a lesbian?
She might just be.
Rosie's a lesbian queen, is she?
But every time Cosmo was on the screen, there's a few close-ups of Cosmo. And obviously, because there's no mouth movement, they do a lot of the like the physical movement. Like, they get the dog to turn its head and move a lot. And Rosie was just like following intently. Like, she got off the sofa and like went up to the screen and was like looking.
Oh, did she?
Yeah, it was very, very, very cute.
It's always interesting whenever pets watch TV.
Sometimes I'm like, what is it about this that grips you here? Like, what is it that is intriguing? Like, Rosie's done it before with Doctor Who, and I'm like, what part of this is for you?
I always see clips on TikTok of, like, but pets just fully watching The Lion King. They fucking love The Lion King.
I haven't tested that one out with her yet. I'll have to do that.
Yeah, let's put it on. Maria Bakalova does a great job as Cosmo. And I like how that it's a good payoff for that kind of mini arc as well, where Kraglin does eventually call her a good dog as she like fucking slams that pig or whatever into the ground.
Oh yeah.
What else? Any other little things?
Not so much the little thing, more one of the like the harshest, coldest lines in this whole thing is when like Peter is cutting into the flesh planet or like station, and he's speaking to Gamora privately, and he's like, "We were so like we disclosed everything to each other. We knew each other so well." And she's like, "Yeah, one second, Quinn," and just calls him by the wrong name, and it's just like, "Oh God!" A thousand knives just went in.
Very funny joke in that scene as well with the whole comm thing. That's very funny.
Oh yeah, and how like Mantis would have. We've been in the scenario where like I'm like, "Hang on, can you hear me? Does my mic sound all right?" Imagine the way we tested it was just me being like, "Hello," and like. just going crazy down the mic.
I like that Peter, that they kind of give confirmation that Peter never actually wanted to go back to Earth. Mm. Like, Peter purposefully was avoiding Earth for so long, which is something I've always kind of figured to be the case.
Yeah.
But, like, I feel like a lot of people have always been like, why doesn't he make a big deal of being back on Earth on Endgame? Like, cause he doesn't want to be there.
Yeah.
It's like where his life was ruined and he's traumatized from permanently.
He's very comfortable with his fighting arena in Endgame looking like grey, muddy sludge and is just like,
yeah.
This doesn't really look like Earth, and then I'm going to dip, so as far as I'm concerned, I was never here.
I'll stick around for this robot dude's funeral or whatever, yeah. But then I'm off.
Like, one thing I was thinking, like, did his granddad, like, see him on the news or anything? Like,
well, his granddad recognizes him, which is interesting because he was an 8-year-old boy.
Yeah.
And now he's
and not Chris Pratt, yeah.
Yeah, and not Chris Pratt. And now he is fully grown 50-year-old Chris Pratt.
Did he have his backpack on? Well. Did he have, like, his childhood backpack?
He did have his backpack, and he was dressed kind of similarly, but still.
I mean, it's still adult man Chris. There's a thing in this where he's, like, where
he's got a beard and a mustache.
there's a fun line in this where Peter goes, like, Earth people only live till 50, and Mantis is like, so you've only got, like, you're almost dead, and he's like, I'm not 50, you're 44, Chris Pratt.
You're getting
I looked it up, like, it's not out of the realm of possibility. Like, delay this movie a couple more years, and we'll see. One thing, Gamora, so I said at the beginning, they have to catch people up to speed. Like, they're like, someone says, like, since Gamora died, Peter's been drinking.
Oh, yeah, they do a quick run through, don't they?
They do, yeah. But how they wave that off, Kraglin literally just, after hearing it, goes, no one tells me nothing, and walks off. And it's like,
that's funny.
Fine, yep. that is sure. Absolutely fine.
Yeah, that's fine. They brush over Peter's alcoholism pretty quickly.
Yeah, he's very quickly not an alcoholic anymore.
Yeah, because at the start of the movie, he's very clearly a depressed alcoholic.
He's like dribbling while standing.
Yeah.
Like, it's not, I don't know, I think they maybe lean too far into the visual language of him being an alcoholic.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, because it's like, Nebula puts him to bed or whatever, and then it's just kind of pretty much forgotten about for the rest of the movie.
And later on, he's like, oh, if I wasn't drinking, I could have done better, and then spends the rest of the movie being extremely competent.
Yeah.
And like, every now and again, I have to remind myself that, like, I know he has, like, the ego in him and all of this, but, like, as far as I'm concerned, in Volume 2, he gave that up.
Yeah, he doesn't have any enhancements anymore. He's human.
So it's like, and there's certain things he's doing, like, that's like a man in his, I guess the movie wants me to believe he's in his 30s. He's not, but that's fine.
He's not.
No, but, like, it's a man in his 30s doing, like, knee slides, spinning round and, like, two gun in it, and I'm like, I don't know about this.
Yeah. I feel like your back is probably aching quite a bit right now.
Yeah, and also, like, you just got shot. Like, you will have got shot at one point. Like, Groot can't be everywhere to be your wall against.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
But yeah.
Fucking Rocky, what's his name? Sylvester Stallone. He's doing the voice on purpose now. Like,
he has to be.
He has to be.
It's way too...
Yeah. We're the Ravagers.
there's a moment where, like, Drax is like, have you got any of different colours? Like, this doesn't match my eyes. He's like, what did you say? I'm like, what did you say? Slow down, Sylvester. Or speed up. I don't quite know what the problem is.
Yeah. Yeah, it's strange. Very quickly, probably a good note to end on, but music has always been such a big part of this franchise and these movies. What do you think of the mix, the soundtrack for these?
So definitely deeper cuts. Like, there's no more Marvin Gaye. But ones that I'd heard mainly from, like, my dad listening to them. But then, like, other ones I've been listening to, and they've been on the playlist since watching Guardians 3. I think there's a healthy mix. I think there's a healthy mix of, like, melancholy, sad, like the one that I don't know what it's called. It's probably Do You Realize, but the one where Peter is just kind of contemplating while on the ship. And it's and it's very slow. Do you realize? And it's just very... That's the one.
Yeah.
Just very, like, I don't know. It's nice. And I feel like a lot of it has a bit more weight to, like, the first two are fun. This one's more like, this is more meaningful.
I think it is probably more thematically mixed well, I guess. More thematically on point. It's probably my least favourite of the three, though.
Do you think?
In terms of soundtracks. Yeah, I think Two is the peak for me.
Yeah, yeah. Also, two was great.
Volume
yeah.
two. Two is just banger after banger. After, two is just... There is not a miss on that soundtrack. And it's so good.
They use two in, like, different ways as well. Like, the using Fleetwood Mac for an action sequence, never heard of before, but inspired yeah. choice, yeah.
Yeah, it's so good. For me, with Volume 3, I mean, the best ones, this is... great, but it's more because of the moment. It's a great yep. moment. Obviously, I'm gonna love this whenever you play it because it's just an absolute, yep.
absolute
great
banger.
Song. And again, just a beautiful moment in the end. You have everyone dancing, celebrating, back on nowhere and stuff. But other than these two, there's not really anything that stands out to me.
That's fair. Really. I think there's also like. There's a more of a focus on the underscoring of this as well, like the actual original composed pieces, yeah. which is weird because like
when the Guardians theme kicks in, it is great as well though.
Like, it is great, but it's sparingly used. Yeah. I wish it was more often.
Yeah.
So yeah. So loud in my headphones. Turn off Florence.
Oh, is it? Sorry.
I'm like listening to what you're saying. I'm like, I think I caught that. Yeah.
But then again, there's one moment. It's, I guess it doesn't really count because it's in a post-credit scene, but like one of the needle drops is like a song from the first movie, and it's like,
yeah, yeah.
But
that's like he's talking about like musical artists, and he's like, this one holds some meaning. And I'm like, and it does for the audience as well.
Yeah, because very nice. Of the movies that we watched. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. last little thing I'll say, just because I wrote it down, and I think it's interesting, like. So like obviously at the end, I'll speed run this. The ending is very sad. It's designed to be a satisfying finale and conclusion to these characters in general. Mm. Even though like Groot and Rocket stay on in the team, like I don't think we're seeing these guys again.
I don't think so either.
No.
Or maybe, but
they're the two easiest ones to have.
Yeah.
Be seen again because it's mostly voice work and then Sean Gunn who has said that he just loves doing this.
Yeah.
But I don't know. So anyway, like Nebula builds, what I put down is Nebula builds, like gets to build a better childhood that she never got for these kids. Drax regains his ability to be a dad again instead of a destroyer. Mantis is no longer like in servitude to anyone. She can just do her thing. Mm. Peter finally acknowledges his trauma, returns to Earth and kind of patches old wounds. And Rocket is a leader. And like we said earlier, kind of like a, he makes the world a better place, but not in that horrific way that it can only, like, he uses his head and his mind, but he uses that himself and not sharing it with like a species or whatever.
Yeah.
But so I've put down like stakes. This movie has incredibly high stakes, but their stakes don't always mean like life and death. It means that like by the end of this franchise and this trilogy, they've all kind of defeated the thing that made them who they were and the thing that they couldn't get past, like the pain that defined them in a way. And they all get to kind of move past that. And I just think, yeah, I think genuinely, as much as I'd love to see these characters again, I think it would be a shame to see them again because now they feel complete in a way. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. I like the fact that they all made it out really because there was a lot of talk during the marketing campaign and like who is going to die and is it going to be Rocket, is it going to be Quill, this sort of stuff, and people possibly being disappointed that they all survived. I'm never someone who thinks like death is the only stake or death is like the only option yeah. available. There's always so much more interesting and different options out there really. So I like that they all made it out and they do have purpose beyond this movie now and stuff. I'll never say no to seeing any of them again. I'll never say no, but to me, I think this is a good fitting ending for them all, yeah. really. So yeah.
I think it would be weird to see it extended in a way. Like, do you know what I would fucking hate? Is, you know how, like, sometimes, like, a Marvel character just sticks around?
Yeah.
Like, I tell you what, like, I haven't seen Secret Invasion. Maria Hill.
Yeah.
Has not done a single plot-relevant thing since maybe 10 years ago.
Oh, I disagree with that.
Do you think?
Yeah.
What was the last thing she was in other than, like, Spider-Man? And Like in my mind, it's genuinely like Age of Ultron, Spider-Man. She was in Secret Invasion. I think, did she die?
She did die in Secret Invasion. Yeah, spoiler alert. Okay.
That wasn't a sneaky Skrull.
No, it was her. I don't know off the top of my head. But she has been relevant. I don't think she's just been there in the background. In the movie she's been in, she has been utilized well and stuff, I think.
I know. Maybe it's a poor example, but like my point is, I don't want to see these characters become background dressing to another story. Like they all deserve their own stories and their own ending, and they got it.
Everett Ross would have been a better example.
Everett Ross is a perfect example. Yeah, just there to be a guy that's there
and a Skrull.
And was he a Skrull as well?
A Skrull, yeah.
Fuck me, who gives a shit? what did you like, just quick thought, like, I didn't watch any, I don't know the first thing about Secret Invasion other than Rhodey ended up being a Skrull.
Yeah.
Like, yes. What did you make of it all?
Some of it was intriguing. Okay. I liked it for the most part.
Yeah.
I felt like it was a good mystery. I didn't hate it like most people did. Wasn't great, amazing by any stretch. I think there was good performances from Emilia Clarke, who I absolutely love. I'll watch Emilia Clarke in anything. Olivia Colman was great, and I hope to see more of her character because she's very interesting. Nick Fury, Sam Jackson was fine, whatever. The villain, Gravik, was particularly very... very interesting and a really great performance from him.
Fairly new, like upcoming actor, right?
Yeah, he was one of the Kens in
yes,
Barbie.
So maybe you're saying.
Yeah. But overall, it was a bit messy. And oh, Mendelsohn as well, great performance from Mendelsohn, who died unfortunately. But
R.I.P.
Yeah. But yeah, a bit. The finale was a bit of a mess. And the whole show was a bit of a mess, to be honest, but it was interesting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
I enjoyed it more than most, but also I can see why people didn't enjoy it. Because it does.
It's one of them where it's like it doesn't really invoke any strong reaction either way.
Yeah. It makes some strange choices, and there's like I the whole Rhodey being a Skrull thing, like, I cannot see him being a Skrull in Endgame at all. I just can't. Like,
it doesn't make any fucking
sense. It makes no sense. Like, you look at his reaction to Tony Stark dying, like,
yeah. No. That's a man saying goodbye to his friend of decades. Yeah.
Especially the way he's, like, characterized in Secret Invasion as a Skrull. Like, it makes no sense. Like,
okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's strange.
Well, there we are.
But yeah.
Guardians 3, overall, very good time. Actually, quite a horrifically sad time. But
yeah.
Great movie.
A good movie.
And also, I tell you what, one last question. Where are you at with, like, so I said this to you a while ago, like, these are the last kind of characters I really have space in my heart for, like, I care about quite a lot from MCU stuff, especially, like, the early days of not early days, but, like, like I was really like vibing with like phase two. That was my shit. I love that. Mm-hmm. And then like these are a continuation on, and they're kind of the last of that era to fall and to have their trilogy capped off and to no longer be a consistent part of that story going forward. So my thing was like, I'm not, like I said, I haven't watched Secret Invasion. Like a lot of Marvel stuff that's come out recently, I've just kind of, if I haven't, like, I haven't seen some of the TV show stuff because if I haven't needed to see it for work, I tend to now miss it. Where are you at with, like, this being, like, a jump-off point, which some people are treating it? And I'm one of them, but I'm kind of dipping my toe back in if stuff interests me, yeah.
No, I'll stick around.
Yeah?
Yeah, no, I've never been someone that's like, oh, Marvel's done or whatever. Like, I'm, like... Sure, some of the recent stuff not been great. Again, Quantumania, not necessarily good. Secret Invasion, definitely a mixed bag. But I'm looking forward to the Marvels. I'm excited to see Loki season 2. Seems quite interesting.
That does look quite good, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll watch what comes out. I probably won't love everything, or maybe I will. Who knows? But yeah, I'll see what happens.
Okay.
I'm not like yes, I'm done, or like yes, I'm fully in. Like, I'll watch the movie.
Yeah. Know. 2 hours is not.
Yeah.
It's not a whole sacrifice.
I'm not going to be like, no, I refuse to watch this movie now because I am done. No more Marvel.
No, but like my thing is like if it strikes my interest, like Loki season 2, it looks cool, it looks good, and it looks well done. So like I'm quite excited to see that. That trailer is hiding Jonathan Majors.
Apparently he's only in that one scene.
He's only in the one. If that is true, it was not intended to be the case.
That's what I've. I say the one scene, probably like the one episode or whatever. But
yeah.
He's not playing like multiple Kangs. He's like that one version of him, whatever he's called. Like, Mr. Look at me, I'm an old timely wizard.
Mr. Iron made the light bulb or whatever he's in that.
Mr. I'm that Chris Nolan movie or whatever.
Was there a Chris Nolan movie about making a light bulb?
No, the wizard movie. What's Hugh Jackman?
Oh,
Hugh Jackman's a wizard. Yes. Hugh Jackman's a wizard, the movie.
Yeah, oh, the Prestige.
Yeah, the Prestige.
So lost for a second. recommendations, Nathan. I've gone first the last couple of weeks, and I'll put cards on the table. I'm not sure what mine's going to be this week, so you go first.
Fair enough. I would recommend anyone who has a spare ticket to the Eras Tour to give it to me because I want to go. And I can't get fucking tickets. I've been trying, Lawrence. I've been trying so hard to get tickets.
I know you have. I almost offered to use my card the other week and it still didn't work. You did,
but it didn't fucking work because of Axis's bullshit payment system.
Yeah.
But whatever. I would recommend Taylor Swift's Folklore, which is my favorite album of hers. It's a great album.
Which one is that? What songs are on that one?
Last Great American Dynasty, Exile, August, The One, This Is Me Trying.
I don't know any of these, but I feel like I'll have heard them. Sing me a chorus of one of them.
I can do better than that.
No, I want to hear you sing it, Nathan.
Listen to those keys.
I hear those keys.
Listen to the sweet sounds of Bon Iver's voice.
I can see you standing, honey, with his arms around your body, laughing.
I think I've seen this film before.
And I didn't like the ending.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah.
It's a great song. Great song. She recently played it as the surprise song Eras Tour in LA. I recommend that. I'd also recommend 1989, but Taylor's version isn't out yet. That's just been announced. That'll come out in October.
So hold off, otherwise you're putting money in terrible people's pockets, right?
Yes. Yeah, 1989 is a very good album as well. That was probably the first Taylor Swift album like I really listened to.
Yeah.
Very good. Some good songs on that. Well.
I like her new one, and I like Red. Red's a good one.
Red is a good album, and you know what?
Nathan is adamant about getting us sued this week.
And you know what? Just while Lawrence tells us about his recommendation,
it might not fit.
hang on. Anyway, Lawrence, please.
Okay. This is not at all distracting with another song going on in my head. Can I turn this down in post?
I can turn it down now.
Oh, yeah. Just a teeny bit. Be good.
Is it not turning down for you?
Yeah, that did, yeah.
Okay.
My recommendation is a movie that I watched for the first time that I feel like... I can't remember if it's one you've been badgering me to watch, but I was working, my wife is off work, and she was like, I'm going to watch a movie. I was like, great, sounds like a good time. And it was one of those movies that I was corner of my eye watching until eventually I was like, I have to put down my work and watch this movie now because I'm quite invested. And that movie is Burlesque.
I haven't seen that.
Was that not one that you've been telling me about?
No, I don't even know what that is.
It's a good one. It's got Christina Aguilera. It's got Cher in it. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's about Cher owns a burlesque club, and Christina Aguilera is a small town girl with big town dreams.
Oh, okay.
And she moves into the not a penny to her name. She has to crash with the bartender of the club as she struggles to make a name for herself in the burlesque club. And she changes it. There's a policy on no singing, just dancing. She's like, I've got a great voice because I'm Christina Aguilera.
Yeah.
Look, don't get me wrong. I've been guilty of being like, what does it mean? If it doesn't mean something, am I going to enjoy it? It's a movie that is about absolutely nothing other than burlesque.
That is very much you.
Yeah.
But what is the meaning?
But I like it, I don't know. Yeah, this, and so I was very much like, I turned to my wife halfway through watching it, and I was like, is this about something? And she was like, no, yeah, it's about burlesque. And I was like, okay, I think I'm on board now. Now I can relax. Like, I'm looking for a deeper meaning. There isn't one. It's just people dancing.
God, you're exhausting.
But yeah, go check it out. Good movie. Under the impression
I've never heard of that, so that definitely wasn't me.
It's up your street. I feel like you'd enjoy it.
Interesting.
I was under the impression that Cher couldn't act from her contributions to Mamma Mia 2. I was wrong. Yeah. She can act.
Oh, well, there you go.
So yeah. Well done, Cher.
Mamma Mia 2 has got some odd performances from some renowned actors, though. So
it really does.
She's not the only one in that movie.
Dominic Cooper, we're looking at you.
I feel like most of the cast, to be honest, are just like, yeah, I'll take $10 million.
Yeah, and a party.
And a holiday to Greece.
Yeah, a $10 million holiday to Greece.
Yeah.
That you don't pay for. You paid the $10 million to go there.
Yeah, exactly.
Great stuff. That's me. That's this.
There we go. There we go.
2 hours, this recording.
I know. I was like, once we got to the hour mark, I was like, right, let's try and wrap this up. And now, here we are, 2 hours in, almost.
We'll shave this down a little bit, I reckon.
Yeah. But anyway,
if I don't do that, and you have stuck around, thanks for that. And your reward is that you get to find out what we're doing next week, which is this. It's not Jedi Survivor.
You can't interrupt Taylor Swift, so I'll just tell everyone now. It's How to Train Your Dragon.
Are you leaving my pause there as well?
Yeah. Well, no, I'm not. What do you mean, me?
Oh, yeah, it's me.
Yeah. This is coming out tomorrow morning, mate.
Oh, my God, I've got to edit this.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be late, but if it's late, it's because I'm on a driving lesson. Leave me alone.
Well, there we go.
That's what I'd recommend. I'd recommend learning to drive for everyone.
You've already done your recommendation.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I have. If you've enjoyed this new episode of this show, come out every single Friday at 10 a.m. You can give us a little follow.
Just one moment.
Oh, fuck's sake. Call me up again just to break me like a promise. Oh. Can you tell, audience, what show Nathan doesn't edit? Nathan, turn this down.
She demands respect, Lawrence.
My apologies. Yeah. Fuck, you completely fucking throw me off my throne. Review the show. Give it 5 stars. Follow us on Twitter, on Threads. They're the only ones we're posting, I think. Yeah? Yeah, cool. At Another Happy Pod. And we have another podcast as well. But Nathan, I would love to know what you think that podcast is all about.
Well, I can tell you. I don't need to give my thoughts on it. I can just straight tell you, Lawrence. It's not an issue for me.
Fair enough.
It's called Still Got Legs. It's all about Doctor Who. Every week we watch an episode of Doctor Who, not in random order, in the order they came out, for the revival anyway. And go through and discuss it. So join us. We're making our way through season 3 at the moment. And it is a good, fun time for the most part. Come along. That comes out every Monday at 10 a.m. again, mostly.
Fantastic news. Goodbye, everyone.
Goodbye, guys.
I'd like to be my old self again.